Well, joining us for this very special interview on Influencers Inc. is Amit Tandon. He's known for his comedy, and a genre that he's really created as a niche for himself in is clean comedy. We find that very rarely these days. So thanks, Amit, for joining us today. I want to talk to you about your journey and the concept of clean comedy, considering that, you know, comedy is never clean these days. So tell us a little bit about how you thought about this concept and how you still manage to make audiences laugh.
Okay. So, aisa nahi ki comedy was never clean. There are actually a few other comedians also who do clean comedy. In fact, sometimes, you know, when I see my YouTube and most of the comments are, you know, his comedy is so clean. We can watch it with our family. You know, this is very clean. And I'm like, कोई लिख दो कि funny भी है यार ये आदमी. Like, but how it all started was that when I started doing comedy in 2009-10, open mics at different clubs, and you know, there I've done some edgy sets in the beginning. You know, I've used language, and you know, I've talked about stuff that I don't talk about anymore. But what used to happen was that even when I started comedy, I was 34 years old. I already had kids. And I was living with my parents. So I was used to controlling language in front of kids and older people. So when I would get on stage and I would see ke there's a kid in the audience or there's somebody above the age of 55, 60, I couldn't talk openly. You know, I could not talk as much as I wanted to. So then I sat back and, you know, one day I decided that let me just write comedy that I can do in front of anybody. So then I'll never have stress ke audience mein koi, you know, below 18 to nahi aaya hua, you know, koi 10 saal ka bacha to nahi hai, ya koi uncle log to nahi aaye hue because unke saamne main gaali nahi de paata, ya main kuch particular sets nahi kar paata. So, that's how, you know, I started doing clean comedy. It was more for my own comfort than anything else, but somehow it worked for people also, you know, and people said, okay, we can listen to it without the headphones, you know, and it became kind of a selling point, as you can call it. So that's the story of doing clean comedy.
Interesting journey out there. I must talk a little bit about how you decide on your topics and the kind of content that you create, because at this point in time, when we look at so many influencers, they have like a content calendar in place where they talk about certain things on certain days. So how does it work for you? Do you have a set content calendar? How do you decide topics?
No, I don't have any set calendar. You know, what I do is I talk about stuff that bothers me. You know, that's where I think comedy comes out most naturally. You know, as they also say that tragedy plus timing is comedy. Okay. So anything that bothers you, anything that pains you, when you start talking about that, I think more people connect with it. Any issue that might happen at my home, it could be around the frustration of, you know, ensuring that your parents wear their mask all the time. They don't meet their friends. That could be a frustration. The frustration could be around, you know, convincing your kids ke, you know, in COVID, they have to go downstairs to pick up the groceries, you know, and, you know, creating slots that, you know, any package between 12 to 3 will be picked up by the daughter, 3 to 6 will be picked up by the son. So anything that I feel is frustrating for me is where comedy comes from for me. I don't keep that pressure of, you know, creating continuously so that, you know, I can, you know, put my reels in time. Because one, I don't belong to that kind of probably the age group who can take that pressure, or, you know, it's not the way that I have ever written. So to keep my social media active, what I also do is that I keep on picking up clips from my old stand up and put them out. Or if there's something genuinely that I want to say, then I pick it up and, you know, I post about it. But there's no conscious effort to ensure that every third day there has to be a post, every 2 days later there has to be a story. So that's something that I've not done.
Right. I wanted to understand what's next for Amit Tandon. You know, we speak to so many influencers out there and they say, okay, the next thing that we want to do is get into a movie or create our own shows. So what is on the anvil? What do you plan to do in terms of exploring your, you know, content and diversify?
So I don't really have a plan. You might not find it believable. See, the way I work is that I had no plan of getting into comedy till the age of 34. Okay. But when I started doing comedy, I ended up doing much more than what I expected. I got, a lot more than what I thought I could get or I deserved. In 10 years of comedy, I performed in what, 30 countries. I have a solo on Netflix, which is the first Hindi solo on Netflix. So a lot of those things have happened. So I don't really have a plan now. I'm just trying to earn bragging rights. That's how I put it out, that I'll just do stuff that I want to. I'm writing a couple of series. So my show is coming up on television. So Sub TV, starting 17th January, there's a show coming up called Good Night India, which I'll be hosting. It will be six nights a week. So Monday to Saturday it will be there. So that's the next big thing, if you want to know. That's what I'm doing. I'm trying to get the YouTube comedy to television to a larger audience. And fortunately, Sub TV has given us this opportunity. We are doing like 102 episodes over 4 months. So let's see how it goes.
Wow, interesting. We wish you all the very best for that. But
Thank you.
I want to talk to you about one very important element when it comes to influencers and monetization. A lot of influencers, including the Gen Z influencers now, are monetizing their content. They're tying up with brands, and companies are more than open for that. So what's your view on how this whole monetization space is panning out? Is it much easier to make money now?
I guess so. It's much easier, and I think it's good because now, even if you have, like, how I see it is, one is people who, like, I don't call myself as an influencer. The reason is I do comedy, and because of that, people follow me. Okay, that's one category of people who are entertainers, and people follow them. Okay, sometimes you will say something that people will like and might do it. I don't honestly consider it as much as an influencer. What I consider influencer is when there are channels which are about specific issues or about specific, like Ranveer Barar, for example. He's talking about cooking. Okay, he's teaching you something, so people follow him for a particular piece of knowledge. Or I know a lady who runs a blog around motherhood, and she has a Instagram account also around how to bring up your kids, and she's, which I feel more come in the in the definition of influencer, because from them people are learning, like a Luke Catino, for example, in the lifestyle space, or Rujuta Devekar, for example. We are more of entertainers, but the good thing is that any form of entertainer or any, they're getting a chance to monetize their content also. They could be sitting in a Kanpur or a Chandigarh, and you could have 50,000 followers, and still, there will be brands who will be willing to pay you X amount of money to, build content for them or to do it. Which I see, when I see it from the point of view of a brand also, I think it's a great strategy for them. Because earlier, for example, if there's any brand, for example, Cadbury's, for example, they make one ad, okay, which will run for the next 1 year, 1.5 years. Right. And it might work or it might not work. So the budgets are huge. But when you hire in the same budget, you end up hiring 35 or 40 influencers. Okay. Now you have 40 different advertisements. Okay. Out of them, 20 will at least work. So the risk has gone down for brands. And the good thing is that as a talent or as a, as an artist, you do not have to pander to the, how do I say, to the, to the beliefs of a producer or a director or an advertising firm. You do your own stuff, you build your following, and then they will come to you and say that, okay, you have the right kind of following that you want to target, and you get
Right.
work. That's the great thing that has happened.
Interesting perspective. On that note, Amit, I'm going to do a quick rapid fire with you. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. What is your favorite form of comedy, stand up or improv?
Improv is more fun, honestly. It's more fun.
Okay. Who are your top three favorite creators in the comedy space?
I think Zakir is there. I like what Usha Kapila does a lot of times. And then this one guy called Mohammed Anas, who's not big, but I find him very creative, you know, in his reels and stuff. Anas is his name.
Okay. If you were stuck in an elevator with one comedian, who would it be? If you had a choice.
I think Zakir, because Zakir ke paas bahut stories hoti hai hamesha. Whenever I'm sitting with Zakir, most of the time I'm just listening to what he wants to say.
Okay. If you could define your journey using one word, what would it be?
Unbelievable.
Okay. If you could go back in time and undo something, what would you do?
There's nothing that I want to undo. I've had a great life. Honestly, I've had a fantastic time.
Okay. Pick your favorite show, Chalo Koi Baat Nahi or Comedy Premier League?
Chalo Koi Baat Nahi.
Okay. And final question, what's your New Year resolution 2022?
Once more, it's to lose weight. Not going to the gym, but trying to lose weight. You know, give up sugar, give up, you know, whatever fatty stuff that I eat, and try to, you know, live a healthier lifestyle.
I think that's been my resolution every year, but it's never really worked out. But on that note, Amit, thanks so much for joining us today. It's been a pleasure speaking with you. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you, Priya. Thank you.